down on the floor. Taking a look at the standings overall right now, we see the rookie in the CrossFit Games, Armando Garcia-Bense, at the top. And again, a division where we've got some existing names with much history, Justin, is it playing out the way you expected it to?
You know, some of these rookies, I just don't know yet. They're making a name for themselves for sure. And so I want to see if guys like Armando and guys that are here for the first time can continue that momentum that they established yesterday. And we'll get a good look at that with this event.
Bar Fight is perhaps my favorite title of the events we've had thus far. What are we going to be seeing?
Yeah, they're going to start off with 12 clean and jerks. They're going to have 155 pounds on the bar. Then it's two rounds of 15 toes to bar, where it's just like it sounds. They've got to touch their toe to the bar. And then 12 chest to bar pull-ups, where they've got to touch their chest to the bar. Then it's back to the barbell for 12 more clean and jerks at 155.
And then again, with this right now, in terms of where the athletes are, if we're looking at an Armando Garcia-Bense again, who is our overall leader there, you see him there in lane number 10. Because he is a rookie, should he maybe pace himself in regards to some of the more experienced athletes?
Well, I think that this is going to be a fast event, but yet it's long enough. I mean, there's a 15-minute time cap. I think we're going to see probably times around, hard to say, but about the 12-minute mark, 13-minute mark. Maybe some of the faster athletes will go a little bit quicker than that. But there's a great deal of pacing with this, especially where there's those two rounds in the middle of the event. So there's some good pacing, and I think they're going to have to be smart and strategic how they attack this event. One that I think has a lot of experience with events just like this is David Hippensteel. He won the games last year, so he comes into this event in sixth place after placing sixth on event number one yesterday. But he's an athlete that I think is going to do really well with this event. And here's our overall leader, Armando Garcia-Bense. I just have what he did yesterday and the stats that he presented to us before the event to go off of. But I think looking at his stats, this is an event that plays well to his strengths.
We'll get set here now for event number two for the Masters Men 60 and over age group.
Athletes stand by.
Here we go with Bar Fight. This is going to be a burner, Justin. What exactly is it going to take for these athletes to walk away with an event win?
Well, I think that the heart of this event is going to be the clean and jerks that you see them doing there. They've got to take the bar from the ground to shoulders, and then the jerk is taking it overhead. So I think that they're going to win this event by doing well on the clean and jerks. It's heavy enough of a weight to make it interesting. Then they've got a lot of grip. It's a grip-intensive event where they're doing the pull from the ground on the clean. They've got the toes to bar. They've got the pull-ups. And so if they can manage their grip, it's going to play well in that last portion of the clean and jerks where they've got to come on strong. And then they've got to be efficient when they're doing the pull-ups and the toes to bar to save enough energy and to do it right so those physical effects don't affect them on that last portion of the clean and jerk event.
There's Hippensteel, who came into this one ranked first overall. He is making his fifth CrossFit Games appearance. Of course, he's our 2016 winner in the 16 over age group. He came in ninth in 2015 in the 55-59 division, also fifth in 2014 in the 55-59 division, fifth in 2013 in the 55-59 division, so a great deal of experience. Now, as we watch the pacing, we talked about this extensively last night. We said it'd be one and go, let it fall to the floor. We're not seeing touch and go. Is that indeed the correct way to do it? Are you being validated by what you're seeing?
Yeah, I mean, if I was coaching an athlete, that's what I would tell them to do. You know, and this is an interesting event just simply because the bigger, stronger athletes are going to love the heavy weights on the clean and jerk, but they're going to hate the body weight movements of the toes to bar and the pull-ups. And so vice versa, the smaller guys are going to do well on the body weight movements like David Hippensteel. I knew him. He's going to crush these two rounds of the toes to bar and the pull-ups. We've seen him, you know, in the past. I think this is his fifth games, and this is a guy that knows how to pace himself. Look at that. He's taking a calculated break there. He's going to minimize that rest period. So this is an experienced games athlete. He knows exactly what he's doing. He's tested this event before, and he knows where to take those breaks. I like to see that. That's smart strategy.
Let's go to Steven Angove over there in lane four. He was our second on the bar. His pacing so far, in terms of what you're seeing, Justin, is this about how you expected it?
Yeah, and I think that he's taking bigger chunks, and we're going to find out if that's a smart strategy or not. It looked like he got six out of the way right from the beginning, so he might be breaking it up halfway. Or I think he went all 12 in a row there, and I'm not sure if that's smart, because you can empty that tank and kind of redline a little bit too fast. That's not something you want to do, and we're seeing that already. Now, you don't want your athlete, if you're a coach, to have his hands on his knees looking at the ground.
Well, I saw from Hippenstiel, he looks like he's doing sets of two and three as he makes his way through this, trying to find his pace, and he's going back to the toes to bar now.
Yeah,
3 minutes in.
And like I say, I think that's a better strategy. It's better to come off the bar while you've still got some gas left in the tank, rather than try to hang onto the bar and run out of that, you know, empty the gas tank.
Hippenstiel vying to become a repeat champion in the 60 and over division again. That is your 2016 60 and over Masters champion. Wide angle, we still see the athletes there. Getting through those clean and jerks, it's a struggle. It's a heavy weight any way you look at it. Back to Angove.
Boy, he's taking big chunks on those. I mean, it's great to get them all out of the way in one fell swoop, but at what cost? And how long is this break going to be in between the toes bar and the chest bars? You know, you want to minimize those breaks.
Angove is making his fourth games appearance. He was second place last year in this division to Hippenstiel. 4 minutes in now. Here in the 60 and over division here.
So Hippenstiel now down to his final 12 chest bar pull-ups. And he's doing pretty much what I expected him to do. He's got a calculated game plan. He's attacking it, you know, the smart way to do it. And
Angove going for some more chalk. That's another thing that we have to consider here. Hippenstiel's wearing the gloves. The other athletes, they go to the chalk. We even heard this at the athletes' briefing. They told everyone, take good care of your hands.
Yeah, we mentioned this at the beginning. This was one of our keys, right? Management of the grip. Because now, after doing all of these sets of these bodyweight movements on the bar, they've got to go back to the barbell. They've got to pull it from the ground. So they're blowing up those forearms. They're killing that grip. Well, that's good technique that Tom's got on that. He's got a nice, strong kip, getting that chest to the bar. A lot of these guys starting to break them up in onesies, twosies, which is okay as long as they can minimize the break. Now here comes David Hippenstiel. And it's interesting to me because he is wearing gloves on this portion of the event. And most athletes will go with a hook grip where they bring their thumb all the way around the bar and bring their first two fingers over their thumb. But David is not doing that. Look, he's just going with a total overhand grip, which to me, it plays into his managing his grip that's been blown up, but also maybe a little bit of lack of flexibility through those wrists.
Oh, he's not just going overhand. He's not even bringing his thumbs around. He's going.
That's what I mean. Yeah, just kind of, yeah.
And he is our overall leader in the event right now. He walked in ranking sixth overall today. And again, looking to make it two in a row atop the 60 and over division.
A nice, good pull. And I like how he's just doing it one. He's taking two, three quick breaths, and then he's grabbing the bar again. He's not trying to go touch and go. This is a smart strategy, and we've seen that he has he's stuck to his game plan.
Now we're going to go back to Angove.
Okay, Angove survived the bodyweight movements. Now he's in familiar territory. He's a bigger, stronger athlete. He's going to have an easier time on this barbell than David Hippenstiel. So we said it before, we think that this event will be won and lost on the clean and jerks, and it looks like that's playing out. So we've got a duel now. They're almost going rep for rep between Hippenstiel in the yellow shirt and Angove in the purple shirt.
Now he's got just four to go for Angove, where Hippenstiel is looking gassed. Let's go down to Nikki Brazier on the floor. She's gonna tell us about Hippenstiel.
Yeah, guys, it's interesting to see this veteran here out on the floor doing a great job, obviously, trying to maintain that lead. And when you think about what it's taken for him to get here, and remember the fact that he's likely training with his daughter, who's also a Games veteran, it's interesting to see how far he can get here. His daughter has actually been to the Games several times on the team side of things. She's been with Team Invictus for the last 4 years. So we'll see if Heather Hippenstiel can give any advantage to her dad here as he fights for the lead.
And Angove comes across just over 720. He is our event winner, and now we're seeing Hippenstiel get Wisdom as well. He'll come in and take second, just crossing it at 7:33. So they go 1-2.
Very impressive by Angove. I thought he was going to lose this event on the bodyweight portion, but man, once he got back to that barbell, Ted, he was off and running.
Now we're looking at Corwin right there in front of us again. He's in his second CrossFit Games. 6 foot, 192 pounds. Trains at Left Coast CrossFit, SoCal region.
Now you're seeing more of just a shoulder press from him. Once he gets that bar to his shoulders with the clean, now he's just a push press almost. He's not even jerking it. A nice, strong athlete, but you can use your entire body to get that weight overhead and not tax those shoulders quite as much.
Let's go back to our overall leader, Armando Garcia-Besne. Slowing down at this point. Hands on the hips. That's not what a coach wants to see.
Exactly. You want to get your athlete, especially in the final portions of this event, back on that bar as quickly as possible. I'm okay going singles at this point. Yeah, so maybe he knows what he's doing, obviously, because you don't want to have that fail. Okay, now we're running. We're kind of emptying the tank. And so it might be a good idea just to take a second, regroup mentally, and then attack the bar. So, yeah, take a second. Get your energy back and then attack that.
And there is the spirit of the CrossFit Games. Angove encouraging his fellow competitors to grit their way through the clean and jerks. And he's making his way out through the field. He's going to try and give a hand to everyone. This is what people love about CrossFit. We just had Rodrigo Dominguez cross just about 9:20.
Down to the final five reps for Armando, and he had a fail there, and it looks like he's kind of running out of energy. We're going to see how he does on this clean and jerk. He's good with the clean, so he gets it to shoulders. He's having problems with the jerk, but that one was nice.
He dipped a little bit more vertically that time.
Yeah, he got underneath that, pushed himself underneath that bar, got his arms locked out at the same time his feet hit, and then was able to stand the bar up.
We're going to go back to lane one now, take a look at Kaslin, CrossFit Garden City. Again, there's Angove on the left, encouraging him on.
And he's doing a push press, so plenty of strength left for Robert Kaslin.
We're getting close here, 10:20 in. The clock is a factor in all these athletes now, as Kaslin will cross in 10:28. There's Hippensteel getting back into it. He's coming on to cheer on his fellow competitors. Hippensteel on the right of your screen, the defending champion in this division.
We talked about that weight being heavy enough to be interesting and how this event would be won on the clean and jerks. We're really seeing that play out right now because it is a heavy weight. It's 155 pounds. We're taking that from the ground to overhead. Clark Holland now, he's got a nice good split jerk. See that? He splits his legs, but he's quick. And I like to see that even now that he's fatigued. And this is what this event is all about. Hey, it's great to be strong with 155 pound barbell with your clean and jerks, but can you be strong when fatigue sets in?
And there's Ackerman.
He says, yeah, I can be. I got a thumbs up. I can be strong when fatigue sets in.
And Holland with a fail there. And how long are you saying to walk away right now?
Well, I mean, you've got to push the pace because guys are starting to finish ahead of you, right? And so those seconds equal a lot of positions on the overall leaderboard. And so, yeah, you've got to take a long enough break to get, it's a fine line. You've got to take a long enough break to make sure that you get the weight. But, man, every second that you're waiting, guys are finishing ahead of you, and that is not good.
While we were talking, Garcia-Besne just came across at about the 12-minute mark again. He was the overall leader entering this event, but that will take a hit. And Holland fights through that one after a fail.
Yep, good jerk. Got those arms locked out fast. Fast feet, fast hands. And Paul Furman down to his final five reps.
CrossFit Games rookie. Came in 19th overall in this division. And he'll grit his way through that one.
Yeah, he kind of caught that with his arms bent a little bit. Traditionally, you want to push yourself low enough under that bar so that when your feet hit, your arms are already locked out. He had to do kind of a little bit more work because he caught it with his arms bent. He had to then press it out. Let's see if he can kind of clean that up a little bit on this rep.
Now he's having trouble with the clean, but again, able to grit his way through that one. Just over 90 left. Let's take a look at Holland and Sullivan there. Holland on your left, Sullivan on your right.
Sullivan really was having a hard time. He kind of got tripped up on that body weight with the toes to bar and the chest to bar pull-ups. Now he looks like he's in more familiar territory with a barbell in his hands.
Sullivan making his fifth games appearance. Again, Holland in his sixth. So two very experienced competitors going back and forth right now with just over a minute remaining in the bar fight for the men's 60 and over masters division here at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games.
And one thing that Clark is doing on the left in the purple shirt is he'll clean it, and he's got a pretty good clean, but he's letting that bar rest in his front rack position for quite a long time. And I mean, that's hard to breathe. You've got 155 pounds on your shoulders, kind of on top of your chest. It's inhibiting, it's making it hard to breathe. I'd rather see him just get it on his shoulders, a quick reset of the feet, and then dip, drive, dip again, and be faster on that push jerk.
And if I can go back to what coaches have told me, it takes away any stretch reflex that is left at this point.
Yeah, it really does. And so that's what I'm talking about there. I'd like to, and he knows what he's doing because that jerk is really felling him there. But I'd rather see him wait a little bit longer on the clean to make sure that he can minimize the time that bar is resting in his front rack.
And that comes to an end. Again, it was Ann Gove, our winner of the event, coming in at 7:22, followed by Hip and Steel at 7:34, and then Corwin at 8:24. So Ann Gove and Hip and Steel, roughly a minute of clear.
And Angove, he took big chunks on those chest to bars, the body weight stuff, the toes to bars, and I thought it was going to cost him, but I'll tell you, once he got back to that barbell, that's where the turning point in this event was. He got back to the final set of 12 on the clean and jerks, and man, he was off to the races. He had a smart strategy, and it came into play, and he did it well.
And you could definitely see his strength take over in that one as he was able to make his way through the clean and jerk. And again, the big chunks that you talked about, again, that comes back to the strategy, something we hit on time and time again. These athletes have to have a plan, and that's why they can't go about looking at all the competitors around them.
Yeah, you've got to stay in your own race. That is for sure.
And again, we are looking here at the aftermath of what just happened here in the men's 60 plus. But let's go down to the floor with Nikki. Nikki, how you doing?
Doing great. We were just talking, this is a big win for you, Steven, and I know that you're a full-time CPA, so how do you find the time to train and make it to games?
It is not easy, especially with the open and qualifier during tax season.
Oh, wow.
So I always am kind of at the bottom, and then once after tax season, get to kind of get back into really training and getting ready for the games, get my body rejuvenated after tax season. So yeah, it's rough.
Definitely something we don't always think about. Well, great job here today.
Thank you.
Steven Angove, our winner of event number two, bar fight men's 60 plus masters division. Now it's time for to make our way to our next event. That is the masters men's 55 to 59 division. And again, we're getting ready for another look at bar fight here inside Alliant Energy Center. And again, with this one, Ted Ramey with you, joined alongside by Justin Judkins. We've got Nikki Brazier down on the floor. And again, with this one, in terms of what we're looking at, Justin, this is a bar fight. What are we going to be seeing when we look at this?
It is. It's a fight. There's a 15-minute time cap on this, and expect them to be fighting the whole time. But the first movement is a clean and jerk, and it's 155 pounds on the bar. This really is the heart of the event. So they've got to complete 12 clean and jerks at 155. Then two rounds of 15 toes to bar and 15 chest to bar pull-ups. Then it's back to the barbell for 12 clean and jerks at 155, and then they can cross the finish line.
Well, let's take a live look at the leaderboard right now, where we are going to be paying attention to Anthony Tursky, who is our leader coming into this. And again, 100 points out of day one, and now he's looking at other people that are going to be nipping at his heels as we make this way through what is a brutal event.
Yeah, Anthony won the run, swim, run event yesterday. It's obviously a longer, more endurance type event. Now we're going to see how he can do with a barbell in his hands and a shorter time domain. And I, you know, looking at his stats and seeing what he's done in previous years, I think he's going to do quite well on this event.
And again, we've seen this so far with everyone. They're never going to be looking at other people. At least that's what we've recommended in terms of this, how it's bearing out. You do see where Tursky is. We're also, of course, going to be paying attention to Erkin, and we're going to be looking at these guys. And again, we hammer home the idea of doing their event and not paying attention to those around them.
Yeah, all of these athletes will have tried this workout probably more than once. And so they've got their own personal strategy. They've got their ways that they've, you know, they've experimented with it. They know where to take the breaks. And so it's going to be fun to watch this play out. Here's Brig Edwards. You know, I think he's going to do really, really well with this event. I don't think he's going to have a problem with the barbell, and I think that's really where this event will be won. But I don't think he's going to have a problem with the bodyweight movements either. So I think Brig Edwards, after seeing him do well last year and previous years, I think this is an event that plays well to his strengths. And of course, your overall leader, we talked about this a moment ago. We know that he can go long and slow with an endurance type event yesterday, but I think that he's going to do really well on this event too.
Tursky there again, three times. This is his third time, I should say, competing here at the CrossFit Games. We are underway now in event number two for the Masters Men's 55-59 division here at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. How do you go about winning this event?
Well, I think this event's going to be won on the clean and jerk. That weight is 155 pounds. It's heavy enough to be interesting. It's not light enough to sprint. And so I think it's going to be won and lost on the clean and jerk. Now, we've got a lot of movements where they're going to be hanging from that bar. We've got the chest to bar pull-ups. We've got the toes to bar. We've got to be pulling that bar off of the ground. And so it's grip intensive. So can you manage your grip for 12 to 15 minutes? Also, movement efficiency on those body weight movements. Can you be efficient enough to save enough energy for that final set of 12 clean and jerks on the barbell?
So we'll see a little bit of confusion right there in terms of where they're going with the barbell. That can happen in the middle of an event. And then Curry will make his way back. He's the first one to get to the bar. Edwards right next to him, also getting on right next.
Now and the athletes, this portion, Ted, I think is where they've got to be the most strategic. Where do you take your breaks? Do you try to get all 12 and risk running out of energy, for lack of a better term? And it looks like he's got this down. I mean, he's going down to the final five reps. But I liked what he did there. He took a really short break. He came off the bar, shook his hands out to kind of save the grip, and then it was back. But we've got a little bit of a turning point, or at least a lead change, as Brig Edwards moves ahead of Curry. And look how calculated Edwards is on the right. He's in the Navy shorts. And he just drops off that bar, shakes the arms out really fast, and then jumps right back. I like to see that. Even though they're down to singles, that's okay as long as you keep your breaks really short. I think it's a smart strategy.
There's Curry on your left. There's Bush, John Bush.
You see that butterfly kip with the athlete in the purple shorts on the right. That's Dennis Cole. He's got a nice, now he's breaking up into just kipping, but he's hanging on that bar and taking big chunks. And hey, is that going to be a smart strategy? Is he going to do enough that he's going to blow up those wrists and that grip? We're going to find out. But now he's done with this first round. Now he's down to his second round of toes to bar and chest to bars. Little bit of a turning point in this event because he surged ahead on this bodyweight movement, Cole did, by taking big chunks. The other athletes are breaking it up a lot more than Cole is.
But you saw Cole as he completed those toes to bars, he started to look significantly more winded than he had about 20, 30 seconds prior.
Yeah. And like I said, Edwards is an experienced athlete. And so he's been on a competition floor. He's had the adrenaline pumping. He's heard the crowd shouting. But he's also tried this. I guarantee he's tried this event several times. He's gone once with a breakneck speed to see how he felt and how it, what his time was. And then he's done it where he's broken it up like this. I guarantee that he's done that.
That's Curry on your left. He's gone from open position of 376th in 2013. Last year, 188th. This year, he comes up and makes his way all the way to 20th ranked overall. He was eighth in the open. And we've got our top three competitors, Cole, Edwards, and Curry right now. Cole came in ranked second overall. This is his Cole's third CrossFit Games appearance.
Sorry, Ted. He's got that nice, strong kip, and he's taking chunks, you know, three, four reps at a time, where Edwards, looks like his strategy is coming into play. Now, here's the determining factor. These final 12 reps on the barbell with 155 pounds. Briggs is a strong athlete. Of course, right when I say that, there goes that grip, right? That grip management comes into play. And he's just push pressing that weight overhead. I'd like to see, if I was his coach, I'd say, hey, let's jerk it. Let's use our entire body rather than just our shoulder muscles.
Curry on the left, much more smooth in his first attempts. Edwards looked like he was struggling, whether it was the grip. Let's go down to Vandervoort, lane number two.
Good, strong pull there, and he's got a push press. So we're not seeing these athletes jerk quite as much as I would like to see them jerk. They do have to press that out, get those arms locked out, hips open, knees locked out for the judge to say that it's a good rep.
Vandervoort is a CrossFit Games rookie. Came in ranked 19th overall into this competition. Back to Curry. He's having trouble with just the deadlift.
Yeah, I'd like to see him lower those hips and really, you know, get in a better position to clean that weight rather than just bend over so much with his hips so high. He's got a pretty good jerk. If I was his coach, I'd say, hey, catch out a little bit lower so those arms are locked out.
Well, this is what we go back to at the briefing initially before the games even got started, where they said this is going to be the struggle, is how much are the abs tired? How much is the grip tired? How much are the lats tired? Everything kind of fatiguing all at once when you get into these clean and jerks.
Well, you're exactly right. Yeah, it's great to be strong, but can you be strong when you're really, really tired? And that's the question that we're here to solve, right?
I think they're doing a better job than we would, at the very least.
Right.
So Vandervoort, he makes his way across the finish line first. The rookie takes event number two for the Masters Men's 55-59 division. The bar fight goes to Vandervoort.
He was so strong on that clean.
Looks like we saw Cole come across to take second.
Gus Vandervoort is not even sweating hard. I mean, he's breathing hard, but he's not even sweating yet.
It's like Boshoven came across as well. Curry makes his way across at about 6:46.
You know, in this later portions of this event, when guys are really, really tired, that's really where the technique comes into play. If you've got your technique dialed in, it really helps you be so much more efficient with that barbell.
And Curry and Edwards bring us into the minds of these athletes right now. I think that says it all.
Well, we're throwing a lot of different tests of fitness at these athletes over the course of this, of the entire games experience. And so how can they answer the shorter, faster, heavier weights and faster events versus yesterday, which was a completely different test of fitness?
Powell crosses the line in lane 20, and there is Cole coming across. Excuse me, I misidentified Bush earlier. So Powell and Cole come across.
David Gass now coming across the finish line. He's got to get that chip across the line there. There's a chip on his ankle, and he wants to make sure that that is actually on the red mat to get his time logged in.
So Tursky comes across at about 8:05. Just the looks on these athletes as they're crossing the line. This was bandied about as one that was going to hurt. It clearly is.
Yeah, I mean, anytime that you're throwing this many body weight movements and this many reps of a body weight movement, like the toes to bar and the chest bar pull-ups, and mix that with a barbell and say, hey, go as fast as you can, you know that there's going to be a lot of pain involved.
And that's Lyons coming across.
Looks like he caught that barbell, you know, in that front rack position. Looks like he might have caught his, as he jerked it, he caught his chin. And if you've done any amount of jerks before, that's happened to me. I think that happens a lot. You'll see some of those Olympic lifters in the Olympics, they'll actually have a mouth guard because they don't want to knock their teeth out. But yeah, he caught his chin with that barbell on the way up with his jerk.
A battle scar for the CrossFit Game rookie, Jim Lyons. Came into this one ranked 10th overall. Excuse me, Tim Lyons, 56 years old, in phenomenal shape.
And that's impressive there. I mean, we saw his body weight, 165. He just did 24 cleaning jerks at 155. So it's only 10 pounds under his body weight. I mean, that's impressive if you stand back and look at it. That is a lot of work done in a short period of time. That's really impressive.
Dandridge, another CrossFit Games rookie. And he knows he's got time.
Yeah, he's still well. Good. Yeah, you're right. He's still well under that time cap.
Dandridge comes in at about 10:12, 10:13, and just had a crowd of encouragement from other competitors all around him. We've still got one out there.
Like I say, this is really where that technique comes into play. He's got a nice strong pull off the ground with that clean. So I'm assuming it's probably the jerk that's really taxing him a little bit. Yeah, it looks like it. He just did a push press there, but he gets a lockout, and it's a good rep.
Gurgly, another CrossFit Games rookie, placed 8th in the open this year. His best finish in the online qualifier was workout number 1, where he came in 16th. You look at his open placings dating back to 2013. He was 522nd just 4 years ago versus all the way up to 8th in 2017. So a testament to perseverance.
You know, we've got a couple things going on here. Number one, you really want, even though you're the last competitor, It's important for your mental state of mind going into the rest of the competition to finish this event under the time cap. You know, you're not going to change places with anybody. Everybody's already finished this event. But just the mental aspect of finishing an event is important. It's also important that you've got the support of the other guys around you. And I think that's just, it's cool. Sometimes the last guy gets the loudest cheers. And that's sometimes all you need, to just push yourself a little bit harder and get through that and get that pressed out, not quite able to do it. He's got plenty of good coaches around him.
If you have the time right now, can you walk away for 30 seconds and just kind of reset? Is it doing damage in terms of his hopes to finish if he keeps on trying to fight as opposed to just giving it a longer break?
Well, you know, he's got 3 minutes and he has 5 reps left. So, I mean, he does have the time to take a step back, kind of get his head in the right spot, you know, remind himself of those good coaching cues. Okay, I've got to have a strong pull, and now I've got to have fast hands, fast feet, really jerk myself and get my, use my entire body, not just my arms. There he goes. Now that's what I want to see. That was great technique now that the fatigue has set in.
Well, he's doing it with grit right now as we've got less than 2.5 minutes remaining here in event number two for the Masters Men's Division 55-59 age group. The 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games here at the Alliant Energy Center in Madison, Wisconsin.
So he took about a minute to do one rep. And if he stays with that pace, he'll have one rep left when the time expires. And so he does need to pick up his pace just a little bit, which is easier said than done when you're right at the tail end of an event like this.
That one came up with a little bit more spark.
As long as he keeps this technique dialed in on the jerk, yeah, he wasn't able to press himself underneath it quite as much. I'd like to see him catch it nice and low, a nice quick, being quick with his feet, quick with his hands. There's no nervousness on the part of his supporters, right?
Just under 90 seconds left. Again, really a CrossFit Games rookie. Came into this one in 2017. He placed eighth in the open.
He has no problem with that clean. At least he hasn't up until this point. Nice good pull. He does a great job with that clean. Looks like he had a nice good. Oh, but he got a no rep. It looked like he stepped out of the box. His back foot stepped out of the step behind that line. It's tough to do all that effort and not make the rep count.
Looks like his foot.
Just over 30 seconds remain.
Yeah, the judge is telling him start with the bar a little bit farther ahead in that little box there. Not only are we getting the support of the other competitors, we're getting the crowd riled up. Oh, he fights through that rep and makes it good.
Now just three reps remain, but he's running out of time with just 10 seconds. Gave a good go of it, but he was not able to finish. But this bar fight event, Justin, is living up, as we take a look at the champ Vandervoort there, totally living up to its hype. I mean, this event is burning people, and we're seeing it in front of us.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, this combination of just destroying the midline with the toes to bar, you know, blowing up the arms with the chest to bar pull-ups, and then saying, hey, let's go clean and jerk a really heavy weight. Yeah, it is taking its toll. Gus Vandervoort really had a great strategy coming in. Handled the body weights just fine, but he was really snappy on his clean. And nice, strong finish. Here comes his last few reps. And he was just push-pressing that weight. So plenty of strength on the part of the CrossFit Triad athlete. And no problem with those clean and jerks at 155. I'm sure he's going to be happy to see heavier weights as the competition continues on.
Let's go down to Nikki on the floor. Nikki Brazier, what's happening?
Well, it has been a long time coming for you, Gus, to get here to the games. And I know that you actually suffered from a heart attack back in 2012. So tell me how that's shaped your fitness journey.
Well, with adversity comes learning. And, of course, 30 years of stress and building a business and eating poorly didn't help me in my recovery. And I started CrossFit 2 years before the heart attack, and thank God I did, because it saved my life. I was 95% blocked in two places in my LAD, and most people, they call it the Widowmaker, and most people die. I recovered with no heart damage, and went on to actually had the heart attack in November, went on to compete in the Open, got 230th that year in February.
Which is great, by the way.
Oh, well, it is what it is. Then I just have climbed back. I've been in the 20s, 22nd, 24th, 26th, and finally this year broke in to the top 20. So I'm here and battling and trying to take care of my body, and also hopefully be an inspiration to other people in my boat who thought they were done. And I have another chance at life and to hopefully motivate other people on the couch with their beer guts like I had and the years of stress and build up. You can get fit again. And CrossFit, thank God to CrossFit and to the community, because without the community and the support, it's not possible. But with it and CrossFit, it's beautiful. And hopefully can inspire some people to get back to that level of fitness, because it's awesome.
Hopefully. We're glad you're here. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Gus, he is an inspiration, not only an inspiration to get back into shape and be healthy, but to come in and knock this one out of the park.
Now we look ahead to the next division as we keep on going on here with the bar fight, and it is it's just a battle so far. We're having fun with it. We're getting set now for the men's 50 to 54 Masters age group, event number 2 here inside Alliant Energy Center, and we're going to take a look at the overall standing setting into this one. Entering it, we've got Glenn Waters taking on the overall lead right now. He is at the top. He's going to be down in lane 10 in the middle when we do finally get into the entirety of the competition. But again, we're looking at these athletes, and again, we're getting more into names that we've seen with more familiarity as of lately in CrossFit, names that I think people are going to be a little bit more familiar with.
Yeah, we really are, and this is a, you know, a traditional CrossFit event where yesterday was longer. It was more of an endurance type event because we're here to find the fittest in this age group in the entire world. So in order to identify that individual, we've got to throw as many different tests of fitness at them as we can. And here's what these athletes are going to be taking on. So it's going to be 12 clean and jerks at 155 pounds. Then they've got to complete 2 rounds of 15 toes to bar, where it's just like it sounds. They've got to touch their toe to the bar. Then 12 chest to bar pull-ups, where they're doing a pull-up, but their chest has to touch the bar. And then it's back to the barbell for 12 clean and jerks, still at that 155 pounds.
Like we said, we have Glenn Waters, who again is our overall leader. He's going to be sitting down there in lane number 10. Right next to him, we're also going to see Duncan Stevens. And again, we're seeing all these athletes that are just going to be right bunched in there in the center right there. And these guys, when they do have that close of a place, when you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in the middle, I know we say don't pay attention. Can you actually not pay attention?
You say, can you not pay attention? Yeah, you can. I think that comes with experience, and a guy with a lot of experience in events like this is Ron Ortiz, one of our larger athletes, but one of our more powerful athletes. And I'll tell you this, he's going to rip through those clean and jerks. Now, will he do well enough on the body weight stuff to stay at the top?
Here we go, bar fight. Masters Men's 50-54 division here at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games.
Look at him go touch and go. This is an athlete that knows what he's doing. He's got a strategy in place. We're going to see him employ that strategy throughout this event. But he's pretty much going, now he's going singles, but he's so fast back onto the bar, it almost looks like he's going touch and go. And he's going to watch him pull ahead on this one. This is another one, Matt Bills. I think he'll do really well on this event. I don't think the 155 pounds is going to be too much of a stumbling block for him. And I think he'll do well on the bodyweight stuff, too.
Again, Bills making his third CrossFit Games appearance. We're just about 1 minute in.
And I think, you know, Ted, I think this event is really going to be won on the clean and jerk portion of this event. There's a little bit of a slip up there, and you don't want to see that happen. That's wasting valuable time on a kind of a mental mistake. You do have to roll that bar to the next portion on the floor before you can start in on those toes to bar.
We just saw Murray making his way to the bar as well, and it was Eastman who had trouble with the bar not putting it out there.
Now the question is, how do you break up these bodyweight movements to save your grip for that final set of 12 on the clean and jerks?
We saw Marco Casali out of that main grouping was the first one to go down. There's back to Ortiz.
And you see Ortiz, we talked about that grip management. He's got those gymnastic grips in order to help save his grip a little bit. And that's smart. If they let you use it, go ahead and do it. Why would you not?
Ortiz, the 2016 champion in the 50-54 division.
And look at that, he's taking big chunks with those butterfly kicks, getting his chest to the bar, but he's really minimizing that break that he's taking. Look. He ripped through those body weight. I'll tell you what, this is an event that's pretty much custom tailored for him because he's doing fine on the body weight stuff. When he gets back to that bar, watch him just pound through those chest, through those clean and jerks.
Let's take a look at Matt Beals out there in lane 8 right now, taking a breather. Third CrossFit Games appearance for him.
He's getting a little, he's got a nice strong pull, getting a little bit of a help from the kip there. Now we're seeing on the second round, they are taking more of a break, breaking them up a little bit longer, and that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that, but you just got to keep in mind, hey, you are in a race. You don't want to take too long on those breaks.
We're taking a look at Waters right now.
And I like how he's taking a really wide grip. What that's doing is that shortening the distance that he has to get his feet to the bar. Even if it's a couple inches, in an event like this, a couple inches can make a big difference over time.
We see Merriam coming out there. He's going to be the athlete back to the bar. Just under 3:30 to get there. Also, at the bottom of your middle of your screen, you had Eisman there coming out. Again, that is Merriam in the lead right now.
So this is where your technique really comes into play. We talked about being efficient on all of the movements. We've got three different movements in this event. Can you be really efficient and have really good technique?
So some athletes in the purple towards the top.
Go ahead, sorry, didn't mean to cut you off there, Ted.
Back to Merriam Ward.
In lane number 9, very fast single.
So he's a little slow on that jerk. I'd like to see him press that, you know, get a good lift off the shoulder with a good dip and a good drive, and then push himself underneath that bar to get those arms locked out fast.
Back to Eisman out there. It's funny, we see them get a couple of reps into this second time with the bar, and they slow down a lot quicker than they did the first time through.
Yeah, they really do. And look at Ortiz. Look how fast he grabs that bar after it lands. I think that's smart. You're going singles at this point because the fatigue has set in, but he's still pushing the pace.
Well, you see with Ortiz, 6'3", 225, his overall size is helping him. But Casale's going to come through at 4:51 to take event number 2 for the Masters Men's 50-54 division.
Casale kind of snuck in there, and so did Koester. And they really did it on that last portion of the clean and jerks. They buzzed through those. Now Craig Eisman is in.
Back to Beals.
That was a great strategy that Casale put into play. He did it so well, he was kind of stealth mode there. Kind of snuck in on that finish mat before anybody else knew what was going on.
We just had Egan Cross in purple. Came through just under 5:40. And then we had Murray come down at the bottom of your screen. Back to Beals there in the yellow. Casale was just there at the bottom of your screen. He was the winner of this event. Beals again gritting his way through, and he was fast off the bar, but getting back to these clean and jerks, he has not been able to maintain the pace.
Yeah, you're right, and this is where that fatigue sets in, and then, you know, you start to leak energy because your technique is kind of breaking down, and you've really got to get a handle mentally on yourself and give yourself those good coaching cues and really try to, as hard as it is, force that technique to be better when you're under that stress and under that fatigue. And that's obviously easier said than done.
So Beals comes through in just under about 6:30. We have Robinson coming in at about 6:40. And this time around, not maybe seeing as many athletes down on the ground after the event. And I guess an event like this, I guess, you know, with the age groups, how much of a difference were you expecting to see?
You know, I mean, it's playing out like I thought. They're having an easier time with the clean and jerks. As the ages get younger, I hate to say this, but as the ages get younger, the times get faster. And I think that's due in large part because they're having an easier time with that 155 pounds. All three age divisions that we've seen here are lifting the same weight.
Montgomery comes across in just about 720 as the event comes to a close. So, yeah, we saw everybody get through it at a pretty rapid pace as well. A very, very impressive outing from our athletes.
Yeah, it really was. And Casale, man, take your hat off to him because no problem with the body weight stuff. Went through without much of a break on those and then really attacked that barbell to finish strong.
And then the thing that I think we're really going to find out of this one is how much did it take and what's it going to do to these athletes the rest of the day, the rest of the weekend, because this was one that people, I think there was more hype about this one than a lot of the other events just because there was so much volume, which you alluded to earlier.
Yeah, and if you've been doing CrossFit at all, you recognize events that are really, really going to be painful. And just having this up on the screen, you can look at it and go, oh, yeah, this is really going to hurt. Here's just Chestabar. Look how strong he is. He didn't take very many breaks, but he took calculated breaks. He's in the purple shirt there, now crossing the finish line. And yeah, he's looking left, he's looking right, and he knows, hey, I just got 100 points towards my march up the top of the leaderboard.
All right, let's go down to Nikki Brazier on the floor. Nikki, how you doing?
We're doing great down here, Marco. That was a big win for you. And as I understand it, before you came to CrossFit, you actually had an interesting background in more of like a yoga type of a sport. So tell me how that's balanced you out here.
The yoga is like for the inner side of the sport. Yeah. So it helps me a lot to breathe and stay there, stay calm and don't rush.
And that obviously helped you out here. Are you looking for that to help you in any particular events coming up here?
Well, the old course, of course it would. Yeah, I never done that. Not an army guy, so I gotta go for it and see what happens.
Looking forward to seeing you out there. Great job.
Thank you.
So that was Casale, who came into this one seventh overall and gets a nice event win here in his second CrossFit Games appearance. And last year, again, he was at a very good showing. Again, gets it in a time of 4:50. And Coaster takes it with a second place at 4:58. And Merriam gets just behind him. So a very impressive showing here in the men's 50-54 division. There's your champion from the 55-59 Vanderbirds. We'll be back with more coverage of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games here at the Alliant Energy Center in Madison, Wisconsin, as we get set here for the women's 60 and over event number two, Bar Fight. And very excited to be with you as always. I am Ted Ramey. I am alongside Matt Jacobson, and we have Nikki Brazier down on the floor, again, covering all the action for you. And heading into this one, again, things are wild across the leaderboard. Any way we look at it, of course, you see Martha Redinger there at the top, followed by Nizakowski. And Mads, I'll ask you, is it playing out the way you expected? Surprises? What are we supposed to infer from this?
Well, not too much, really, to be honest with you. These athletes have had one event so far. This is about when it gets started for them. Things may change up a lot, so enjoy the fact that Redinger and Misikovsky are doing really, really well, and let's hope that they hold on to it, but they will be challenged.
And again, talking about this event, Bar Fight, people have been hyping this one up. What exactly are we going to be watching from these athletes?
So these athletes are going to do 12 clean and jerks. They're picking the bar off the ground up to shoulder position and then overhead. It's a 105-pound barbell. After 12 repetitions of that, they'll be going on to two rounds of 15 chest-to-bar pull-ups, 12 chest-to-bar pull-ups, and then they will finish off with another 12 clean and jerks at 105 pounds.
Taking a look at the lane assignments, of course, we are going to be seeing Redinger there in lane number 10. She is our overall leader entering this event. And what we keep on coming back to is doing your own race, paying attention to what other people are going to be doing. What are the factors as they pertain to where these athletes are situated?
It's going to be really easy for these athletes to get caught up by the fact that somebody else is going to get to the bar sooner than they are. What's really important is that they've had enough time to try this workout out at home. And so what was it, the strategy that worked the best for you, and then stick with your guns as this happens. So Martha Redinger came off a good event start, a good start yesterday. She finished in first place in the run, swim, run event, and that's going to give her a great mindset to walk onto the floor today. She knows that the game plans that she has works out, and she's going to look for to be able to continue that. Debbie Mizikowski came in second place yesterday, and obviously she's sensing blood in the water, and so she's going to try to go for it today. And I'm looking forward to seeing if the battle is going to be between these two athletes or if there's a sleeper in there.
And Mizikowski, as we take a look at her right now, 60 years old, 5'4". What's it going to take to win this event?
I mean, this is not your typical event. What you're going to look for is to remember that it's won or lost on the clean and jerks. Then after that, you've got the issue of grip management. It's grip intensive on the barbell, grip intensive on the bar when you come back to gymnastics and then back again to the barbell.
We've got ourselves a bar fight here inside the Alliant Energy Center. Masters Women 60 Plus 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games, event number two for these competitors. And right off the bat, we're seeing Cartwright attacking that ball with bar with fervor. And is that the goal? Do you just go for the gusto? Is this going to be a mentality where you say, I'm going to be tired no matter what, just give it my all?
I would not recommend that for any athlete out there. Stick with your plan. Be conservative with your energy to start with so that you can maintain the speed you want in the gymnastic movements and then have a strong finish on the barbell. We've seen in the past with the men that they're going to be able to get out here on the barbell a little bit slower than some of the other athletes, but catch up beautifully on the last clean and jerks.
Of course, there's Phyla with a very good showing so far.
And for Phyla and all the other female athletes, what I'm looking for is exactly what you're seeing Phyla do right here. It's a power clean. She needs to be fast to get under the bar, rack it really well, so she's not fatiguing her shoulders any more than she has to. I would ideally like to see her drop just a little bit further down on that jerk, because it is going to be really taxing on the shoulders otherwise. See there, she catches it not quite locked out with the arms, and that's just that little press is going to cost her so much energy. Now, she may be strong enough to handle that, but it could be done easier.
She comes into this one ranked fifth overall after the first day. You see Holt to her left and Thistle on the far left of your screen.
And I mean, a 105-pound barbell is light enough to think that you should start going touch and go, but it's also heavy enough to really take a toll. So you're going to have to be really smart about how you negotiate this.
Beer on the right. And then you see Pia Gunz on the left. And we're seeing the continuing relationship with the judges. At times, it seems like the judges are their best friend, sometimes their worst enemy. They're telling them where to set up to make sure they don't get a rep, but we've seen them also, the athletes, be unhappy when they don't get credit for a rep.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, what you're seeing, both, you saw Pia Gundo do it, you see Lydia Beer do it as well, is have a conversation with your judge all the time. That way, they will be your best friend forever. That you know what to do, they know what you, and you know what they're looking for as well.
Lydia Beer comes in second overall in the seeding. She was sixth in the open. In the games in 2016, she was second in this division. Back in 2014, she was 16th in the 55-59 division.
And you're seeing her be really smart about her kip. She comes down, has a little swing in the bottom, and then goes for the next rep. Instead of forcefully throwing herself back down there, taxing her grip, her shoulder, and her midline more than she has to.
Let's go back to Fela and Holt, lane 7 and 8. Holt on your left, Fela on your right.
And so Fela right here finishes her toes to bar, moves up to her chest to bar. It is important to be efficient in your movement patterns. You just don't want any extra energy just kind of flailing off to the sides and expending more energy than you have to. Fela here is holding on a little bit on the way down on her chest to bars, but she's got a beautiful rhythm.
You can see Holt there getting back up on it. Fatigue setting in.
It is, and this is when I'd like for Julie Holt not to get fazed by the fact that other athletes are moving ahead. Stick to your game plan, and then when whatever is in your wheelhouse shows up, that's when you put the pedal to the metal.
Julie Holt came into this one ranked 11th overall, 6th in the open. In the games in 2014, she placed 13th in the 55-59 division. And how much do we look back at games experience? Is it always what happened in a previous event, what was I able to get through, or is it totally dependent on the level of fitness they're displaying entering these games?
Well, the mental game, having been here before, you're going to have a huge advantage with the mental game. You're used to being in this setting, a huge crowd, it's televised, all the stress that goes around, that could pop up with everything around you. So, I mean, that's going to make a difference. But physically, it's all about what do you bring right now.
Now, Lydia Beer there on your right, she's going to the underhand grip, just using, trying to bring her biceps more into it because she's shaking it off. She's fried up top right now.
She is, and that's going to be a lot slower, and it's going to take a lot out of the grip. It's a lot of time under tension for her forearms and her shoulders, and that's going to take a lot out. At the same time, feast your eyes on the left side of your screen. Rafaela is doing a great job at strategizing, getting the reps that she wants in there, and then getting off the bar before she gets completely fatigued and technique starts to go out the window.
Does this one really play to her favor because she is relatively smaller, 5'2", not even 120 pounds?
Well, I think it does. At the same time, we saw Ron Ortiz on the gentleman's side of the house, and he's a big athlete, so I think it's more about playing to your strengths and making sure that the game plan that you have really is the one that you're sticking to.
There's Holt on your left. She's already gotten some no reps called on her on the toes to bar. So it looks like her, and you can tell she can't even get her feet up right now. So her core is smoked.
Exactly. It could be her core. It could be that she's starting to feel her shoulders. It may be her grip that's starting to fatigue. There's so many factors that play in. I mean, usually in your home box, you're used to the equipment. You know the barbell. You know all these things. You get in your favorite spot. This is a different animal altogether. But I'm just impressed with the way that Fela is conducting this. I mean, she's doing really, really well.
And almost 6 minutes in.
And remember that these athletes are 60 plus years old. I mean, just with the athletic prowess of being able to do this when you're 60 years old. This is CrossFit rewriting the book on what is acceptable fitness levels for different ages.
Fela makes her way back out to the bar.
So what I'm looking for now from Fela is to be decisive and fast on the clean, and then retracting her hip after that initial push. Being able to extend the arms, beautiful. Now just keep that up, girl.
Yeah, for her first attempt getting off the bars and coming back to the barbell, she did not seem to have much trouble with that in the slightest. And again, good form, very smooth.
It really is, Ted. I mean, it's an excellent point because that's exactly what we're seeing. And the smoother she is, the easier it's going to be for her to maintain the speed going all through all of these instead of getting stuck.
The other thing we're noticing with Fela, all three of her cleans up to this point have been identical.
Exactly. And that's what you're looking for. I mean, you may look at a technique and go, that is or that isn't textbook. What's more important is that it's a technique that works really well for this particular athlete.
And the foot placement, she's getting her feet wide, so she's bringing her body under it, but not having to dip down enough to bring the legs into it.
Exactly. And she has tried this at home, and she probably knows that that does a great job for her. Shoulder mobility-wise you need more shoulder mobility if you're going to retract the hip more. So stepping a little bit wider is going to help her to get that depth.
Let's take a look at Moore and Stojković.
And you've got Beer. Beer is still on her chest, to bar pull. The finish is off now. At the same time, you got Pia Gunn right next to her. And like we talked about before, staying in your lane, sticking to your game plan. They're both doing that really well.
You can see Gunn looking for some momentum to help those toes get up to the bar. Whereas Fela on the left, she's powering through those cleans and jerks right now.
And Gund actually doing a great job, even though she's not getting a lot of a kip. You see her shaking her head, but I got to tell you, I'm pretty happy with what she's doing. Once she gets going, she gets good, clean, fast reps.
Closing in on 8.5 minutes.
And Fela on her last reps, and look at the technique. It's almost, as I say that, she starts split jerking it. The athletes can split jerk. They can push press it. It's just get it overhead.
But continually, that clean is the same time and time again. And yes, the shoulders, the arms, they're going to get tired after hanging off the bar, after doing already the round of cleans and jerks before this. But it's just the consistency. There's no breakdown in her form, even if it isn't, it's per se, the prettiest we've ever seen.
Exactly. As she's finishing up right here on the right side of your screen, you've got Martha Redinger, who came in with the lead, and she looks to get this done as well.
Fela will cross the line, 9:10 to take event number 2, Masters Women's 60-plus division. The bar fight here at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games.
And she's got to be happy with that. That was just consistency to a par. Great job initially on the clean and jerks, not frying herself out. Small, snappy sets on the toes to bar and the chest to bar, and then identical reps almost on the last reps as well.
Taking a look at Jaeger right now. Just the pacing. She's coming back. She's making the lift, backing away, coming back for another attempt. 61 years old, 117 pounds.
And what we just talked about before, she's trying to push press it, and that's just really hard. I'd like to ideally see her just retract her hip a little bit, get the arms extended, and stand it up using her legs.
Came into this one ranked second overall. She was 11th in the open. And smoother with that one. So after the miss, she's back on track.
Just brutal power. I mean, after all the work that she's done already, she's just insisting on going with the push press, and it works. And it looks like she's picking up the pace a little bit. She had a bit of a longer rest before the last two reps. Now she's had a couple of reps where she's just stepped back, shuck it out, and then gets back on it again.
With athletes' experience like that, you can tell she did some sort of an adjustment. How much of these athletes are they able to identify in real time? They said, okay, I know what I did wrong. Because we know that when you're in the middle of one of these events, you might not be able to think the most clearly about your form at all moments.
Absolutely, that's definitely true. And that's where it's important that they've had exposure to some of these workouts in their home environment, in their boxes at home, so that they know this isn't working, this is plan B.
Back to Jaeger for another attempt. She'll grit through it.
It looks like she will grit through it. I'm just happy to see the small adjustments that she's making. She's driving her elbows a little bit further forward, getting a better rack position, which serves her well on the push press.
Jaeger on your left, Havard on your right.
And Havard is doing a great job with that split jerk. I mean, it's not necessarily as fast, but since they're not cycling the barbell, that's a great way to go. Preserve some energy. Get your legs working instead of just your shoulders.
Havard was the champion in 2016 in the 60-plus division. 2015, she was 21st in the 55-59 division. She came into this one ranked fourth overall.
And Yeager on her last reps. Now, what's important is that even though she sees the judge's hand go up, she cannot be phased and start pushing the pace. She does not have time to get missed reps.
Well, since the miss for Yeager, one thing I have noticed that her approach to the bar and her setup has been identical. Her hits are coming up a little bit higher than they were earlier, but as she walks up to the bar, it's been the same each time since the miss.
And it's a natural thing to see that happen. Once you get off the toes to bar and the chest to bar, you may address the bar and go, that's 105, I've got it in the bank. But, I mean, you're slightly fatigued. So it's a learning experience on the first 2 to 3 reps, and then after that, they get right back into their groove.
Havard made that last one look pretty easy. Getting a little bit more leg drive under it. Closing in on 13 minutes here.
These ladies are doing an amazing job right here. It's like I said before, and I will be saying it all through the games, it's just an impressive thing to see people this fit at this age. It just means that age is not an excuse anymore in any way, shape, or form. These are athletes, purebred.
We saw Holt there still having trouble back on the bar. Bottom of your screen right there, that's Monk. It's going to go back to lane 12. You've got Havard.
And that was Yeager finishing up. Like you said, beautiful technique on the last reps.
And that's one that could have gotten away. After the miss, she could have let that one kind of slip, but she regathered herself. As we see now Havard coming in. Looks like she's got about 4 reps left.
And her technique has been really, really good as well. And, I mean, she's been a lot faster. She came off the gymnastic part of this workout a little bit slower, but she's been making a really, really good ground on these clean and jerks.
And her power under the bar right now, that's what's really helping her. She's not trying to do it all with her arms.
Exactly. And her clean looks effortless as well.
And so Havard to the top of your screen will make her way in at about 14:10. Now we've got just over 40 seconds remaining here. Let's check out what's going on with Lee Monk out there in lane 1. Just over 30 seconds remain.
Great front track position, but just does not get under the bar.
And about 30 seconds to do it.
We'll have to regroup from here.
And a lot of these athletes right now, if you haven't had exposure to the CrossFit Games or bigger CrossFit competitions in the past, this is when you want to not give up and just keep remembering that every single rep counts.
10 seconds. We're going to count it out, ladies.
So another miss for Monk, who came into this one ranked 9th overall, 9th in the open as well. She wants to get one more, but she says it's not there. And so bar fight comes to a close for the Masters Women's Division 60-plus here at the 2017 CrossFit Games. Yeah, let's get a look now at Phalo. We'll go to her toes to bar, where we can talk about what made her so effective.
What made her really, really effective and what was the winning key to her was being able to strategize short, snappy sets, both on the toes to bar and the chest to bar, getting off before she was fatigued. And once she got to the barbell, it was a learning experience on the first 2-3 reps on the last ones to make sure that you got the technique right. But after that, just consistently knocking them out.
All right, let's go down to the floor with Nikki. Nikki?
Man, this was a great way to kick off day 2 here for you, Patty. And I know that you were a gymnast a little while ago. How did that help you here with those bar movements?
You know what? Honestly, I think my yoga.
Really?
Because, I mean, I did gymnastics a long, long time ago. But I maintain a pretty good yoga program and involves aerial yoga and other land yoga. And I really think that the fluidity of the movements, it relies on good mobility.
Wow. Obviously very well-rounded athlete. Great job here this morning.
Thank you so much.
And so what this does, Phalo coming in here, I mean, we had Redinger and Mizikovsky in the lead to start with. Phalo, Yeager, and Havard make a really good outing, and that's going to shake up the leaderboard, and it's going to give these ladies a lot of confidence moving into the rest of the CrossFit Games.
All right, we are live here at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games Alliant Energy Center as we're getting ready for our next event. It is the Masters Women's 55-59 division, event number two for them. More bar fight here for us. We are having a good time with this one. And again, we are seeing great performances here inside the Alliant Energy Center. And again, Ted Ramey alongside Mads Jacobson and Nikki Brazier down there on the floor. And let's take a look at the standings as they exist right now as we are well into day two. Donna Aramo right now, she's sitting in number one overall. We're also going to be paying attention to Donna. Bruce, what are you seeing out of this so far, Mads?
Well, Donna Kemp absolutely crushed the run-swim-run yesterday with a really dominant performance. What we've seen before in the event that just happened is that there are some sleepers out there. They've been biding their time, and they're looking to make a move on this.
All right, let's talk about bar fight. What are we going to be seeing from this brutal event?
So these ladies are going to start by doing 12 clean and jerks at 105 pounds. They're then going to move into two rounds of 15 toes to bar, 12 chest to bar pull-ups, and then they're going to finish off with 12 clean and jerks. The clean and jerks are 105 pounds.
Taking a look now at our lanes, we've got Donna Aramo at the bottom of your screen. She'll be in lane number 10. She, again, is the overall leader. Next to her, we're also going to see Jennifer Kemp, and we're also going to be looking at everybody out there. But, I mean, this is one of those events, again, where if you're a leader, if you're close, you're going to be paying attention to everybody that is out there. But you got to make it your event and have your own plan, your strategy. And we've seen that, though, that if you're an athlete that's in the lead, then someone comes out of nowhere, it's hard not to let that shake you.
Oh, it is, especially with a setup like this, because you're going to see who's moving off the gymnastic part of the event the fastest and moving on to the barbell. But you cannot be fazed with this. One or two, no reps, and you're getting caught.
Now with Aramo here, Mads, what exactly are you expecting to see out of her? How is this potentially going to or not going to play to her strengths?
What I'd like to see is a confident outing on the first 12 clean and jerks. I'd like to see short, snappy sets on the gymnastic movements that will give her speed and will buy her time to just go out there and be consistent and confident and not having to push herself through the 12 clean and jerks. And so Jennifer Kemp right here, she's in second place. And you know that she's going to be looking at Donna Aramo and going, I'm going to catch up with her. This is my event. The strategy is going to be the same, but these athletes all need to play to their strengths and not to their weaknesses.
What is it going to take for these athletes to win this event? How do they manage all the various aspects of bar fight?
It's all about the clean and jerk, making sure that you don't overexert yourself on the first ones. Then it's grip management through the gymnastic part of the movement and through all of it. Or the event, and then through all of it, it's movement efficiency, clear, pure movement that will allow you to conserve energy for that last sprint.
Getting set for bar fight here, women's 55-59 division, 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Here we go, bar fight, 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games, women's masters division 55-59. And they come at the bar with speed, a little bit more amped up at the start here compared to the last division.
Absolutely. What we're going to see is that as we climb down in the ages, they're going to be a little bit faster. We're probably going to see less of a mobility challenge for some of these athletes as well. And that's just going to increase speed. That being said, them being fast, it's easy for a couple of people along the line to start dragging everybody into deep water. If you have some Olympic lifting experience, you may want to go faster. I just hope nobody else gets caught up in it.
15 minutes in this event. And again, we've talked time and time again. It's not the clean and jerk here, but it's the clean and jerk after they go and do the pull-ups and the toes to bar. That's when we really see who can shine on this pull.
It definitely is. I mean, if you walk out here and you overexert yourself to start with, then you're going to be staring at that pull-up bar for a long time wondering what went wrong.
There's Dean out there in lane number 5 right now. Trains at Lightning CrossFit.
And she's got a lot of games experience, and it pays in. I mean, you didn't see her looking at the other lanes at all. She's just staying in her own, sticking to her game plan as she casually makes her walk back to the pull-up bar.
Yeah, last year she was fourth in the Masters Women's 50-54 division. 2015, she was eighth, 50-54. 2014, she was third in 50-54. She knows what she's doing. Again, there's Aramo on your right. right now. And on your left.
We talked about movement efficiency. What we just saw Dean right here was amazing. And we're seeing over here on your screen, Pradamidas is doing a great job as well. Slightly shorter, more powerful athlete, but efficiency in the movement.
2 minutes in, 13 to go. And this is where we see the differences in pacing between the athletes as they go in between the toes to bar and the pull-ups.
Exactly. And you know that everybody has a rep scheme that they would ideally like to stick to. However, that should never be an iron cast game plan. Go, if you feel it, go out there and do a couple more. If you don't feel it, don't get stressed if you have to drop off the bar a little sooner.
Yeah, in an event like this, there is no active moment of rest. Expect these periods right now, which you're seeing from our two competitors, when they're off the bar.
Exactly. It's not really as much rest that is as it is managing their effort to make sure that if they need to push a little harder later, they can do so. I just love to see the technique by Dean right here. I mean, she's doing great on the gymnastic movement, making sure that she's not expending too much energy, but getting the reps that she wants.
Three minutes in, just about 12 minutes to go. Masters, women, 55-59. 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. There's Clark on our right now. Looks like she's moving at a good clip right now.
Exactly, and you're seeing a little bit different technique on Clark here. She's a bit snappier by when she brings her knees to her chest on the toes to bar. And then as she moves on to the chest to bar, once again, Dean on the left side of your screen, Clark on the right. Clark isn't quite as comfortable in the chest-to-bar pull-ups as what we've seen Dean in the past.
Clark won this division in 2015, the 55-59 division, and in 2014. Make a move over there. We're going to take a look at Marybeth Prodromidis.
And Prodromidis is, like we said, a very powerful athlete right there, and she's doing really snappy reps as well, minimizing the time that she's on the bar, which will serve her well when it comes to the clean and jerk, because her grip will be fresh.
She's putting in full display that she's done her ab work in the past, and that's paying off right now.
It's just nice to see when these athletes stick to their game plan, because, I mean, it is going to serve them well, not just today, but in events to come as well, that they haven't overexerted themselves.
Now, if you're one of the athletes right there, if you're a coach to one of these athletes who's still out there on the floor, what are you telling them?
Well, basically what we talked about before, that every single rep counts. Now, this may not be the event that you're looking forward to, but there will be events to come where you can make a mark, so do not despair. Just keep on trucking and remember that this is all about your games experience, and there will be plenty of times to push later.
Kelly Dean taking it absolutely one at a time right now, and it's working well for her. Go up, get the rep, come down. It's the pacing, where as we learn more and more about this event time and time again, it's pacing that's paying off.
It really is, and as you alluded to in the start, just stick to your lane, stick to your game plan. Don't get caught up with everybody else.
These are the two leaders right now, first and second place on your screen, Dean and Clark.
And I got to tell you, I was telling you a second ago that Susan Clark, she didn't look like she was as comfortable as Dean was on the chest to bar. But she got a technique that fit exactly what she needed it. And it gave her a great chance to get back onto the barbell as soon as she wanted at this pace. And she's got a pretty good lead.
Clark came into this one ranked 7 overall. She was 3rd in the open. So it's been a good 2017 for her. But Clark is already down to her final 5 repetitions. You can see her there in the middle of your screen getting a nice lift up.
And
back to Dean.
And Dean right here, she's cycling that barbell pretty fast. I'm wondering if it was just on the first reps or if she's actually trying, if she thinks she's going to be able to catch up with Clark.
I'm going to ask you, in your moments of competing, did you think to yourself, I can catch up? Or if you did, would that only serve to burn you out sooner than it otherwise would have happened?
Trust me, I have tried to catch up with other people and it never worked out the way I wanted it to. But then again, I have never been to the CrossFit Games as an athlete. These people have. So their athletic prowess and their capacities far exceed what I bring to the table.
Again, Clark having a little bit of trouble slowing down, but she is on her final reps. And Dean is coming on strong. And right now, Clark working towards another attempt.
And now Debbie Downing.
And Predominus is also back on the bar, so we've got three ladies right here. And it's all about who can get the technique dialed in to minimize the cycling time of that barbell.
Now we're seeing the form change in Clark on her clean to get it up. It's starting to hit a little bit more lower on her chest, and she's fighting to get it up into that rack. 7 minutes in.
And Predominus gets it just before Clark, but that was a close call. That was very close.
And she comes across about 2 seconds before Clark. It looked like we saw Dean come by as well. So 1, 2, 3, all within about 10 seconds of each other.
And we talked about Predominus and how she looks like a stronger and more powerful athlete, and that's exactly what she was. She came off the gymnastic part of the event and just was really fast on the barbell.
You can tell she's winded right now. We've got Jennifer Kemp crossing the line. Just caught the tail end of her running off there. But we've still got a glut of competitors top to bottom of your screen. And when you start seeing the other athletes finish, do you get a little bit of a boost from that? When you see people finish, you think to yourself, this can be done? Because there are moments where you think to yourself, I can't do this.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, there's no doubt that you start seeing people finish this and you're like, this is it. I'm going to get after it myself. And as I said before, they know that they've got a lot of events to come. And everything they do here will be awarded later on. I mean, we're going to see that in the scoreboard. So there's absolutely no reason to tap out. Just keep on trucking, making sure you get good, solid reps.
There's Bonnie Lynn out there, trains at CrossFit Synapse, SoCal region, 55 years old. She was 8th overall heading in this year. Hecht will cross the line at 8:38.
And we've gotten a lot of athletes who finished now. And this is going to shake up the leaderboard quite a bit.
Bonnie Lynn comes in just after 8:45.
What's just really important is that if the athlete gets a little bit stressed out, that they do not abandon technique. We talked about it in the start that the key to this is efficiency of movement. Efficiency creates speed.
And you saw Downey moving left to right from your screen. She'll come in and finish just around 9:10. Just over 5 minutes remaining. Howard crosses the line just over 9:30.
And you're looking at these athletes, and what I'm looking for even now is that as soon as you get the clean into that front rack position, what I really want to see is I want to see him get that overhead as fast as possible, not expending a lot of energy in that rack position. Snappy, get off the bar, get back there, and then get a faster cycle time.
Lindley getting a clean lift. Looks like she's going to be on her final five just about now. And some of the athletes come over to start encouraging her.
And that's really what we're all about. And they may not hear their coaches out there, but you know that they're getting a bunch of really good tips from the other athletes who are already finished.
But she's still showing good form at this one. So it looks like that's the thing about these athletes. We spend so much time assuming that it's going to be the clean and jerk that is the problem, that it could have been the other bar movements where they're hanging, where that was what slowed them down.
Oh, most definitely. Which is why you need to make sure that you have a game plan that has a little bit of leeway to be able to compensate for these things as you get deeper into it.
Just over 4 minutes remain. We've still got three athletes out there on the floor right now watching Lindley. You can see Forte there that was just at the bottom of your screen. And then Lindley's going to come across just at about 11:02.
I am impressed by the effort by these ladies. I mean, 105 is no joke. And to be able to start with that before you move on to the gymnastic part of this movement, I mean, it does set you up for a lot of trouble a little bit later, but they're negotiating that beautifully.
Well, we saw Herring come in, and right now, Nella Forte still competing. She was tied for 18th coming into this.
And you
She's
know
out there in lane one.
And you know that she wants a strong finish moving into the rest of the day.
It looks like she's close to her final reps. And then Aramo still sitting out there on the bar. Everyone coming around Aramo right now.
And what Aramo needs to do, and it's easier said than done, I know this, but as she's on the chest to bar, you see her, she's almost at the bar. She needs to get a little bit more hip action on the way up and then squeeze between her shoulder blades, fulfill that movement that she generated with her hip by pulling all the way in. Otherwise, she's going to have to come further up, and that's just taxing the shoulders, the arms, and everything.
And we did say Forte coming there at about 12:10. Let's go to Nikki Brazier on the floor.
Yeah, Donna Aramo is doing an excellent job out here, you guys. It's actually all in the family for her. Her daughter, Christy, is an accomplished games athlete and is also here this year. Also, a big year for her. She just had a grandson in July.
But she's still fighting her way out there in lane 10.
I mean, look at the athletic prowess and then tell me that she's a grandma. It's just, it's insane to me. And I just cannot stress enough how impressed I am with the effort that these athletes are putting forward.
So right now we have Aramo and Kuzar out there right now. Aramo, she's got her work cut out for her. Less than 2 minutes remain.
And she's got a lot of people out there helping her out right now. And I think what may have happened is she just got to the bar a little bit too fast, very aware that the clock is ticking for her.
Right now, what are these athletes telling her in terms of encouragement? What are they trying to get and convey with her when they are around her?
Well, it's hard because it's on one side, you're trying to give them enthusiasm and you're trying to get them fired up about the fact that they know they've got it. At the same time, you want to give them technical tips as well. However, you're not necessarily working out with this athlete on a day-to-day basis, so you're not sure what should I be saying. What they should be saying to both these athletes is, dip underneath it so you get your elbows forward, you land in the rack position instead of grabbing it and then driving your elbows forward, because that's just expending a lot of energy. And then after that, jump it up as far as you can, retrieve your hip just a little bit so you get that stretch on the arms, stand it up with your legs.
I've seen Aramo here and Kuzar just absolutely struggling through these reps. And again, this is bar fight. This is one of the most hyped events we had coming into these games, and we learned of that, and we're seeing exactly why, because these are the best athletes in the world and they're being pushed to their limits right before our very eyes.
I mean, one of the quotes we heard coming into this is that you have got to be great just to get to the games, and this is true. So, I mean, I'm just impressed with what they're doing. Last or not, it's impressive.
15 seconds remain now. Aramo looking to get one more. And right now, Kuzar just can't get it past about her mid-abdomen level.
And that's the grip management we were talking about before. I mean, you just fried.
And so, bar fight. Masters Women's 55-59 comes to a close. And again, like I alluded to, absolutely living up to the hype. And we're seeing these athletes just put them through the paces. Let's go to Prometheus on the replay and again see what she did so efficiently. We talked about this.
Well, she got on there and she was really, really good at making really fast reps. She got fast reps on both the toes to bar, the chest to bar, got off the bar, preserved energy enough to be fast and cycle the barbell really, really fast.
Again, she came from behind in that one and really showed herself to be strong on the clean and jerk. And again, just an absolutely fantastic performance from her. And then again, we see if she can carry this over into the next event.
Well, I wouldn't be surprised if we get to see her produce the same kind of performances all through the weekend.
Again, just you see these athletes going and talking to all those in attendance here at the Alliant Energy Center. It's been great seeing the throngs of people just walking around the entirety of the games. Let's go down to Nikki Brazier on the floor. Nikki?
I'm with Mary Beth, who we're used to winning these events, but as usual, in true Mary Beth form, it's not about her or about CrossFit, and she's got a very special message today.
I do. I dedicate this win to Axel Winch.
He's got a friend who's struggling, so this is important for her. Now, Mary Beth.
He's in the NICU.
He's in the NICU. thank you. I want to ask you this. I know you're going for another championship here. Last year, after you podiumed, we watched you do backflips. Are you going to do that again this year?
Oh, I don't know. It's whatever comes up and I feel and I am in the moment.
Well, we love watching you. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
It is an absolute pleasure to see an athlete like this go out and put on a perfect performance and then show that it's about something bigger than what she's going through right here. She has the experience, and she's going to be doing this all weekend.
Let's take a look at our overall results. Again, we had Prodromides as the winner at 7.08, then Clarkin at 7.09, and then Kelly Dean at 7.14. They all came within 6 seconds of each other. That is absolutely fantastic. That just shows you how close these athletes are. As we saw, there's a wide range of variance in terms of the times, and the top three were right on top of each other.
They were, and this is a result that's going to serve Clark very, very well. I mean, she came in third, she finishes, she does this, and if she can keep up this kind of performances, we're going to see her at the top of the podium.
Now it's time for us to get set for the Masters Women 50 to 54 division here inside the Alliant Energy Center. This is event number two for these athletes, bar fights. And we're going to take a look at the overall standings as they come into this one. Colleen Fahey right now is your overall leader, again, followed by Cindy Kella and Lecky Feynman. And again, I ask, Mads, is this surprising? Is this playing out the way that you expect it to? Because every year there are so many surprises. Athletes come out of nowhere.
Oh, there really are. I mean, there are a couple of athletes that I think we're going to see trying to make a move here, but I'm not surprised to see Cindy and Colleen do a really good job on the initial run swim run event, but they are going to have to hold their own in this event.
Yeah, we're taking a look at the athletes, and I'll ask you, Mads, you know, as we look at this, who are the athletes you're going to be paying attention to, at least before we see it completely disrupted?
Well, I am going to be looking at Colleen and Faye to start with. Amy Mandelbaum is also another one of the athletes who've been here a long time. Marion Valkenburg shows up with great power and strength. I mean, there are just so many athletes to look at. So looking at the ladies that started out well is key, I think, to start with.
So what are we seeing out of this event?
So the ladies are going to start by doing 12 clean and jerks at 105 pounds. They're then going to move into two rounds of 15 toes to bar, 12 chest to bar, and then finishing off with 12 clean and jerks once again at 105 pounds. The cap is 15 minutes for this workout. I know that a lot of these ladies out here will not be needing it.
And now we're going to be taking a look at where these athletes are. Again, in the middle, we're going to be looking at a lot of our top athletes. You see Colleen Fahey there at the bottom of your screen. She's going to be in lane number two. Up top, you are going to see Kim Rogers. And again, this is the idea that these athletes have to do their own event as opposed to paying attention to those around them.
Definitely. They can't get caught up in what anybody else is doing. If they do, then they're probably going to blow their grip a little bit later. And, you know, just stick to your guns. Stick to your game plan. You've worked it out before. Believe in it.
And again, let's talk about Colleen Fahey right now. She's another one you wanted to pay attention to.
Exactly. I mean, she came out of the run, swim, run event, winning that event. Now, that doesn't necessarily say a lot about this event, but it does tell you something about the mindset that she came in with. She's not here to just compete. She wants to win.
10 seconds. And Cindy Kelly. Bar fight is underway, event number two for the Masters Women 50-54. And as we see them go out, let's talk a little bit about Cindy Kelly. What were you looking for out of her?
Well, Cindy Kelly, I mean, she had a great outing yesterday. And she knows that if she can keep that up, just like we saw Susan Clark do in the heat in the previous age category. If you see Kelly, if she can keep this up, it's going to set her up for a really, really good day right now. And that carries on throughout the rest of the weekend.
And then you can see Kelly with a bit of a hitch there, and she had some struggle getting that press up. Let's talk about what it's going to take for these athletes to win this event, Mads.
Well, for them to win the event, they are going to have to remember that it's won or lost on the clean and jerks. That's where they can really, really make a move. But it's also where they can blow themselves up and get themselves in trouble for the gymnastics. So have a good plan for your clean and jerks. Grip management, making sure that you don't overexert yourself. And as a consequence, you have to negotiate the technique. That being said, it's movement efficiency. Movement efficiency comes from being fresh and knowing how to do the exercises when you're a little bit out of breath. But I want to see clean, pure movements that will allow these athletes to do really well and cycle through them fast.
54-year-old Fahey making her way back to the bar after the clean and jerks. You can see we're starting to get these athletes on. Ms. Chisnick making her way through the toes to bars right now.
But
And I like to, it's easy to think, you're going, well, you know, it's going to be 15 chows to bar, 12 chests to bar. I'm just going to haul it. I'm going to throw everything at it. It's easy to do that. However, if you do that, you may very well put yourself up for a unpleasant experience on the clean and jerks a little bit later.
There's Carrie Napoli out there in lane 17. She came into this event today ranked 14th overall.
And again, you're seeing an athlete just short sets, making sure that there are no reps out there.
Yeah, she seems to have a plan in terms of how many she wants to do. She came off the bar when she wanted to, not when she could.
Exactly. And that's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for a good, clean movement, but also an athlete that has a great a game plan that will allow them to be strong and determined when they get on the bar.
She came into this one on your right, Napoli, ranked 20th overall. Eddington on the left came in ranked first overall. She was fourth in the open. She was the champion in this division in 2016, fifth in this division in 2015, and then 2013, she came in third in the 45-49 division.
Shelly Eddington is not an athlete that you're ever going to discard in any way, shape, or form. She's always going to bring everything that she's gotten. She's shown in years past that she's got both the mental game and the physical capacities to do really well.
Again, we're just about 3 minutes in. There is a 15-minute cap on this. Napoli showing some body language that she's feeling this one already.
But she's shown that from the very first repetition. So it may be just the way she goes about doing her business.
Eddington is just strong overall, though. It's going to help her. You look at her benchmark lift. She can back squat 225. She can clean 170. A clean and jerk 170, which is going to help her in this one. She's got a snatch of 130. She can deadlift 301. So she's got the strength after she gets to these bar movements. Once she gets to the barbell, it's going to give her a distinct advantage.
I mean, she's got all the tools in the toolbox, most definitely. And even though we see her just resting on her knees right now, which is something that you normally don't want to see, I'm not too worried. I think she's just got a game plan. She knows exactly what it is she wants to do to set her up for success on that barbell.
Let's get out to lane 4 and take a look at Amy Mandelbaum.
And Amy's another one of these athletes who we've seen out here before. We know that she's capable of doing a great job. She's utilizing the chest to bar, or the butterfly chest to bar, which is great because it saves energy on the pull, but it is pretty grip intensive.
We've gone past 4 minutes, under 11 remain. Mandelbaum again, gritting her way through doubles right there. And at this point, should a coach say, hey, take it one at a time?
Well, at this point, I don't think she's going to be able to hear her coach, to be perfectly honest with you. So she needs to know that there's a plan A and there's a plan B. Does it or does it not work out?
Let's go back to Eddington and take a look at how she is doing. Looks like she's got about 5 left in the pull-ups. Or no, she's all done. All right. Well, she's back to the bar now. And she's in second right now. And now everybody's coming out all at once, seemingly. 10 minutes remain.
And in the middle of your screen, you've got Marion Valkenburg, also a seasoned competitor. And I know for a fact that she is strong to boot. And I won't be surprised to see her go make short work out of these clean and jerks.
She has big lifts across the board. 53 years old, came in ranked 2nd overall this year. Last year, she was 5th in this division in the CrossFit Games.
And Marion has worked extensively on her shoulder mobility, and you see that paying off right now. In years past, it has been an issue when she was going overhead, but it looks really, really good for Marion right now.
There's Sarda right there in the center of your screen.
And Sarda doing a great job of push-jerking that barbell. She gets her hip low, extends her arms, and that's just a great job by her.
And we are starting to see Sarda cross the line first, 5:53. She is the winner of bar fight for the Masters Women's Division 50-54 here at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games.
And here Marion Valkenburg jogging towards the finish line.
Valkenburg will cross the line just about 6:12. The two of them both made that look easy as they came across the line. Now we've got Stewart coming across, left to right on your screen at 6:23. Now Feynman coming across at about 6:26.
These are amazing times for these ladies. I mean, 105-pound barbell is no joke after what they did. I'm impressed. Love to see this.
We're almost at the 7-minute mark. Paying attention to Fahey right now. Up there in lane number 10. We're seeing Kelly to her right. Looks like she's getting towards her final reps as well.
And it's counterintuitive. As you get more tired, you don't want to re-dip your hip after the initial jerk up, but that is exactly what these ladies are going to have to do, and to avoid getting that extra little press on the bar.
Cindy Kelly came across at just about 7:05. Fahey's getting ready. Just a couple more reps. We're back to Napoli on the left of your screen. And Napoli, she's clear to run to the finish. She'll come across at about 7:27. Still keeping an eye on the entirety of the field. In the middle of your screen in the blue shirt, there's Faye. She's done. She'll make her way across at about 7:39. And these athletes are just putting up awesome times. There's Velo over there in lane number 5. She'll cross about 7:45. These athletes just putting up phenomenal times right now. Still under 8 minutes. Two athletes remain out there in the field. We're at the 8-minute mark. Christy Lunny came into this one ranked 9th overall on the day. And then Tammy Joaquin out there, she was ranked 4th overall. She's sitting in lane 12. So that's Joaquin on your right, Lunny on your left, and Lunny gets the clear to go to the finish line. She'll cross at about 8:20. And now all eyes are on Joaquin as she has to work to wake her way through this. She's done. She'll come across and she'll break 8:30. Just absolutely phenomenal times here today from the Masters Women's 50-54 Division Bar Fight 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. What a showing. Let's take a look at Sardo right now and see what she was able to do so effectively.
And look at her last lift right here. Still able to drop onto the bar, get great extension on those arms. And that's what gave her the fast cycle time on the barbell.
I love the look left and right as she realized that she was out there in the lead coming in first. You could see her start to smile as she came in. Happy with her performance, as she should be. And now these athletes know they've got a lot of work ahead of them yet to come, but she can walk away happy after a great showing from there. And these athletes, again, Bar Fight, totally living up to the hype across the age groups.
Definitely. I'm just impressed by the speed and by the ability to maintain great technique even through fatigue from these ladies.
Again, getting a look at some of the fans here in attendance. It's been loud inside here. Fans having fun. And of course, there's the next generation of CrossFit athletes that we're getting a look at. Let's go to Nikki down there. Nikki.
Jose here not only had an incredible performance, she also has an incredible fan club that printed these huge pictures of your face. How much do they mean to you?
Oh my God, it means everything. They will always be there for me, support me, encouragement me, and just to be here today and this weekend, for me, it's a dream come true. That's all I wanted.
And you did a fantastic job.
First place, for me, it's wow. It's well, amazing.
Well deserved. Great job, Jose.
Thank you very much.
Jose Sarda, a performance that perhaps surprises even herself. She comes in ranked 6th. To this event, she gets the win, and that will shoot her up the leaderboard as the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games continue. Now taking a look at the official results as they come in. We get Sarda at 5:53, Valkenburg at 6:11, and then Stewart at 6:22. Not as tightly grouped as the previous division, but still these times these athletes are putting up, Mads, absolutely phenomenal.
They are phenomenal. It just speaks volumes of the athletic capacity that these ladies have and the experience they bring to the table.
And they're getting better each and every year. All right, that wraps it up for us for now here at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Well, we will be back later. Again, 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games.